In a quiet neighborhood just west of Disney World in Orlando, media and protesters gathered outside the winter townhome owned by former Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin and his wife. Chalked Concrete explained why.
It's very obvious that this is an institutionalized issue. It's systemic. It's not a conversation of bad apples.
Chauvin is the officer seen around the world pressing his knee against George Floyd's neck after he was cuffed, ignoring his cries for help.
No justice! No peace!
Outside his Florida home, locals holding signs kept it peaceful.
No justice! No peace!
But used the moment to be heard.
No justice! No peace! How long they gonna keep doing this, man?
We will put pressure in the most peaceful but just serious way that we can.
Inside, Chauvin's home appeared to be empty, curtains drawn.
Whether he's in here or not, we feel like we need to let our voices be heard.
Neighbors could share few details about the couple who would only visit sporadically and kept to themselves, they said.
The only time we would know if they were there is if the dogs were there barking anytime we come outside.
It ain't going down like that in Florida.
Not here, not anywhere.
That's right.
In all, Chauvin's home in the Sunshine State attracted several dozen people. Who, despite distance to the Twin Cities,
George Floyd! George Floyd!
Felt compelled to share the same message.
George Floyd!
We want justice, we want charges, we want to see some kind of change.
My turn?
If you're a Florida parent, it's safe to say the choice to send your child back to campus this year remains nothing short of nerve-wracking.
We went back and forth a lot.
Perfect.
For James Shaw and his wife, the decision boiled down to a deadline and an 8-year-old's desire.
She's had to hang out with mom and dad for like 6 months, and I wanted her to be able to be with her friends again.
For Barbara Mellon, it's life for a single working mom.
I don't have much of a choice.
But still a work in progress, what Florida school districts plan to do if a student or staff member tests positive for the coronavirus.
I don't have the what-if plan.
We surveyed Florida's 67 school districts and asked a series of questions, hearing back from just about half. Of those who responded, all will require the person quarantined for up to 14 days, what the CDC recommends. Less than 10 will mandate at least one negative test before the person can return to campus. And a handful plan to make the entire class get tested. But most school districts who we heard back from said if there's a positive case on campus, they'll seek guidance from their local health department.
And the idea that, oh yes, we'll just call the health department and they'll send someone over. I mean, it's pie in the sky.
Dr. Mona Mungat is a Tampa Bay immunologist and member of the Committee to Protect Medicare, which recently warned Florida's governor that without more safety measures, schools could become COVID-19 super spreaders. She's concerned most school plans rely on families to self-report symptoms and health departments already strapped for resources and staff.
All of these school reopen plans are based on almost like a fairy tale scenario.
The heart needs you go again.
Leaving parents to play a game of chance.
Do I have concerns? I do. My wife does. We're nervous. There's no question about it. And yet I do. I truly believe that they have our best interests in mind.
It's one of the most visual impacts of COVID-19 on everyday life. Meat shelves bare, everyday products gone.
All of our team members are working around the clock.
And inside Florida warehouse centers like Star Distribution in Plant City.
Never seen inventory come in and go out so quickly.
In the chain of supply and demand, they are the middleman, providing products to more than 300 retailers around the state. From appliances and pharmaceuticals to food.
When everybody came out and was buying more than they needed, it really took the normal flow and supply chain flow and really washed it.
Larry Jimenez is vice president of business development here.
What has been your biggest surprise?
The biggest surprise is how fast the products are turning and the manufacturers are trying to keep up.
Take, for example, olive oil. Typically, they'll turn half truckloads of this in a day. Now it's full truckloads. And the demand keeps coming. And check out these disinfecting wipes. Typically, this distribution center keeps about 1,000 of these pallets on hand here every day. Now, they're down to 25.
Many of them are dealing with challenges
that we're basically used to because of hurricanes.
But while Ken Armstrong, president and CEO of Florida's Trucking Association, says the state's history of hurricanes gives its supply chain a leg up in the game of catch-up, COVID-19 still presents unknown challenges for the entire industry.
A month-long hit, and then how big a drag on the economy is it going to be? Is it a year-long hit? There's just so much uncertainty right now.
At Star Distribution, Jimenez tells us employees are taking extra precautions while working around the clock to keep up with the game of supply and demand that doesn't appear to be easing up anytime soon.
I really believe that we've now seen the peak on the supply chain side and that our customers are going to be able to keep up with the demand.
Industry experts tell me every day the pace of manufacturing products to delivering them is now getting faster, which means you, the consumer, should hopefully start seeing the products you need on store shelves more frequently.
This is our main production floor.
At the Tampa headquarters of Global Widget.
Our gummies are the most popular product.
Business is back to being fruitful.
We've come through the entire COVID situation with better strategic focus.
In April, the four-year-old company, which manufactures CBD-infused products, laid off nearly half its staff due to COVID-19. 68 employees.
It was the first time we've ever done that.
2 weeks later, it was approved for just over $3 million in federal Paycheck Protection Money, or PPP.
We wouldn't have laid them off, but as fast as that happens, you found out like on Thursday at 5 that you were approved and you got funded the next day.
This hemp distributor, among at least two dozen Florida companies we found who reported making mass layoffs to the government over COVID-19, but managed to secure federal help due to the pandemic.
You laid off a bunch of people and then you got a bunch of money.
That's correct, and we hired back those people.
The company's chief compliance officer tells us in addition to rehiring all 68 laid off employees, they've hired 8 more.
Without that PPP money,
we would not have rehired all those folks for sure.
We brought back most of them.
The Jewish Community Center of Orlando received just under $700,000 in Paycheck Protection Money in April, not enough to bring back all 136 people it laid off in March.
Because we don't have 8 classrooms, I don't have jobs for those teachers.
Revenue is still down, leaving the not-for-profit to lay off about a dozen more of its staff since.
We've had to make adjustments to match the economic reality.
Around the state, car dealers, hotels, and restaurants are among the businesses we found that reported mass layoffs despite securing PPP money. Some restaurants, including this one in Miami, remains closed with plans to reopen soon, according to its website.
We're running the company just like any other company.
Back at Global Widget.
We're just as legitimate as any other dietary supplement company that's out in the marketplace now.
While the FDA has yet to regulate the natural hemp industry, business here is booming.
We employ 176 people in Florida.
With plans to hit 200 by the end of a year that continues to produce so much color.
I'm Katie Legrone in Tampa. For the first time, daily school logs are revealing just how difficult it is for schools to track the coronavirus on campus.
These school district spreadsheets expose the realities of what schools are dealing with on a daily basis while trying to educate students in the classroom during a pandemic.
It's challenging.
We had no idea what to expect.
The reports provided to us by 4 school districts through a public records request are daily logs submitted to Florida's Department of Education detailing confirmed cases of COVID-19 on campus and its impact.
Every day is a challenge.
In Okeechobee County, the district's population is small, just 6,400 across 10 schools. But daily COVID logs to the State Department of Education show small isn't immune to virus challenges. Take the teachers who test, but don't tell until days later when the results are positive.
If there's any kind of miscommunication, then that just kind of could hamper what we're trying to do.
Or the positive student whose doctor, according to school logs, never told his parents to keep him home or even contact the school. That one student forced 30 to be quarantined.
We literally go through each class period. We go through bus rosters. We just try to make sure we're not overdoing it, but we don't want to underdo it either and then lead to more, you know, more sweeping.
Daily temperature checks, constant monitoring, and seating charts have helped overall numbers stay low in the district.
We don't want to have one person be responsible for sending home 100 students or staff or anything like that. So that's what we're trying to avoid.
which is exactly what happened within the first week of school in St. Lucie County. Football teams at two schools impacted.
All of those players were quarantined for 14 days, and many of the coaches as well. There were no additional positive cases from either one of those.
In Pinellas County, one student case also impacted the school's football team. 41 students quarantined. In Polk County, a teacher's case forced more than 120 to be quarantined. As school district leaders, their biggest challenge...
Just make sure that we're getting it right.
Less than half of St. Lucie's district student population is back on campus. As of last week, it reported 35 positive student cases, with 480 total students quarantined since day one. That is, what they know about. Like any district, if the coronavirus has taught nothing else on campus... It's that trust is everything.
I have to protect, and each one of us have to protect, our children and our staff members. And so we have to be very, very honest, very trusting, and very, you know, and tell it like it is.
All summer long, I thought that I was going back.
I used to think I was going to be a lifer.
They are Florida teachers who believe the mix of COVID in the classroom left them with no other choice but to flee from campus.
I wanted to make the decision that I felt was right for me.
For the past 3 years, Carolina Tave was deemed a highly effective elementary school teacher in Pinellas County. This year, she resigned just days before classes began.
I started hearing what was, you know, the conditions under which I would have to work, and I didn't think that those conditions were optimal, were safe.
After spending 6 weeks trying to teach both in-person and virtual to special ed students in St. John's County, Danielle Raposa decided to leave last Friday.
I was doing about 12 conferences a day in a 7.5-hour time span and expected to make miracles happen.
For the past month, we've combed through school district records around the state, seeking the number of teachers who have resigned, retired, or took a leave of absence since the start of school. We found hundreds. In St. Lucie County, 36 teachers dropped out halfway into the first semester, double the number this time last year. In Orange County, 118 teachers are gone, a 25% increase from this time last year. And in Hillsborough County, a district spokesperson told us they have 100 more teachers on leave right now versus a year ago. Not an unusual pattern, a district spokesperson told us in an email, adding they're not concerned.
It is not normal at all.
But the president of the state's teachers union is concerned. While there are various reasons why teachers leave in the middle of a semester, Florida's union points to the state's mandate to reopen campuses during a pandemic.
We know right now that school districts have massive shortages. They had it before COVID. It's been increased under COVID.
But by how much isn't known. The union, which has a pending lawsuit against the state for forcing in-person instruction, typically tracks teacher shortage numbers, but hasn't been able to get a reliable count this year. In Pinellas County, a district spokesperson reports 32 openings for both instructional and non-instructional staff. And search teacher on Palm Beach County's district website, and you'll get more than 850 job listings. Danielle and Carolina have moved on.
I do not regret the decision that I made under the current conditions.
Both now work for the state-run Florida Virtual School, after hoping to make the classroom work, but realizing this year the risks versus rewards.
You can only do so much.
If the election of 2020 is showing us anything early, it's passion.
Our current president and his administration are complete idiots.
I love what he's doing in terms of ending wars, spreading peace.
With 2 weeks until election day, 3 million registered voters in Florida have cast their ballots.
I'm here just to make sure that my mail-in ballot gets to where it needs to be to the supervisor of elections.
Early voting has broken records in multiple counties, including Hillsborough County,
dropping off your ballot,
where this in-person early voter summed up the feeling.
Well, I'm happy to hear it. Oh, I'm so relieved. I'm so relieved.
The numbers show early voting is still being dominated by registered Democrats, with nearly 500,000 more votes cast than registered Republicans. Still, 3 million mail-in ballots have yet to be returned.
While early mail-in ballot numbers show Democrats comfortably leading Republicans here in Florida, now that in-person early voting has started here, experts will be closely watching how the numbers shift and if a red wave is coming.
Well, I hope so.
I think that you're going to see a lot tighter race by the time all is said and done.
With roughly 11 million registered voters in Florida, political analyst Dr. Susan McManus says early voting is used more as a party weapon than any crystal ball.
Vote by mail and early voting helps the candidates narrow down who to really pitch every ounce of energy they have to get them to the polls.
Campaigns call it micro-targeting, the hardest part of politics in any election, especially this one, where passion...
I think that the choices this year are very clear-cut, normal versus crazy.
And party pride.
I think the media gets a lot of things wrong about him, but I'm a huge fan.
Fly high. It's been a long, lonely summer for Penny Phillips.
Last night in particular, I was in tears. I just couldn't hold the tears back because I said, this is 5 months this week.
5 months since she's held her mother's hand, sat face to face, or even in the same room with her.
I just felt like, how much longer can this go on? I just want to see her. And she wants to see me.
Pre-COVID, Penny had been at her 91-year-old mother's bedridden side every single day.
I'll do anything to really, I'll test, I'll wear whatever garb they want me to wear. Just let me into the facility and I will be good.
Last week, the governor announced he's considering ways to reopen long-term care centers to visitors and created a task force to develop guidelines. While they have yet to meet, during a recent Zoom interview, the head of the Agency for Healthcare Administration, which governs Florida's nursing homes and assisted living facilities, told us rapid testing will likely play a role.
That is going to be a game changer in helping to further our efforts.
Since our interview, we've learned the Fed started shipping rapid test kits to nursing homes hardest hit by the virus. 471 Florida centers on the list.
Excited about the potential that holds in turning around results quickly.
Well, they're sending the wrong kind of test to facilities. They're sending antigen-based tests. Antigen-based tests only identify those residents who have full-blown symptoms of COVID.
Instead, Brian Lee, executive director of nonprofit advocacy group Families for Better Care, says molecular-based rapid tests are needed since they can detect asymptomatic people. The FDA acknowledges on its own website that antigen-based rapid tests, while cheaper, are more likely to miss an active coronavirus infection than molecular-based tests.
We've been calling for this for months, and they're just not listening. So it's allowing more people to be exposed and to die.
Lee believes molecular-based rapid testing is the only safe way to let family members back in.
I'll do anything. I'll go for testing, I'll go for whatever, but I want to see my mom.
Penny Phillips doesn't care what kind of test she may be subject to. She only cares that the days left to see her mother in person again are numbered.
She really doesn't want to go until she's is able to be in the same room with me again.
We are conducting a community-based test site supporting the citizens so they can get their COVID tests.
Here at the site, I'm testing the patients that come through.
We've been here on site for about 4 weeks so far. I'm Daniel Herrera. I am a combat medic.
Lieutenant Colonel Tina Mattavoy.
Noelia Rendon. I am a combat medic.
Throughout the various sites in Florida, there's over 2,200 soldiers. Florida National Guard has tested over 38,000 right now.
Patients will pull up in their vehicles.
We'll explain what's going to happen.
Hello, my name's Noelia. I'm here to test you for coronavirus.
Put them at ease if they have any nerves or any fears.
They come in, they see us with our personal protective equipment, and they're scared.
We're the first person that they come in contact with.
Usually I'll just word it in a sense that makes them laugh. So I'll kind of say, hey, so if you have to sneeze, fortunately you're going to be sneezing on your husband or your boyfriend or the person right next to you or someone else in the vehicle, but just not on me, please.
I'll just tell them this may tickle.
What we're trying to portray is that we're here with them, essentially, to fight this thing together. This is my hometown, and this is our community that we're trying to help.
I have family in South Florida, Central Florida, and North Florida, so through the entire state.
So in a sense, it is more emotional, and I am more connected to the mission.
This is affecting neighbors. It's affecting, you know, possibly people that, you know, we know we're close to, family members.
There's always some fear in the back of my mind.
The fact that it's an unseen enemy.
But that's really why I signed up. It's to be able to help the community and the country and as much as you can, really.
This is really awesome to be able to provide the support to the community. I know our soldiers are very happy to be here, giving back to where they live and being able to make a difference right now.
Whether we're here or we're stationed in any other part of Florida, it's important that the community knows that we're here for them. The mission doesn't change regardless of the location that we're in, but it's definitely, it's great that I've been able to work here close to home.